acknowledge that we gather at the Santa Rosa College, Junior College, on the territorial traditional land of the Pomo people and the Coast Miwok, past and present, and honor with gratitude the land itself and the people who have stewarded it throughout the generation. This land acknowledgement calls us to commit to continuing to learn how to be better stewards of the land we inhabit. We recognize that every member of the Santa Rosa Junior College community has benefited and continues to benefit from the use and occupation of this land since the institution's founding in 1919. Consistent with our values of community and diversity, we have a responsibility to acknowledge and make visible the college's relationship to Native peoples. By offering this land acknowledgement, we affirm Indigenous sovereignty and will work to hold Santa Rosa Junior College more accountable to the needs of the American, Indian, and Indigenous people. Yahweh ho. Thank you. So with that, I will turn this mic over to Dr. Chong. Thank you.
Oh. Good morning, everybody. I'm the opening act for George Sellu today, and I'm really excited. Everybody says, oh, this is your last PDA, Dr. Chong, and I tell them I'm finally going to get to graduate. So I'm really looking forward to today, and the Tauzer lecture is one of all of our favorite event to see the type of talent and intellect that we have at the college, and the ultimate as an educator is to share with your colleagues. So it's just really a pleasure. I want to thank the PDA committee for all their hard work in setting up breakfast on the coldest morning of the year, of course. So let's give them a big round of applause. So as I do look back on my last year here, can't help but have some reflections, and please indulge me today. In the last almost 12 years here, I've had a chance to reflect about what the college has been through and all that it's been through. And some of you have been here with me for the 12 years and even more. And others are here more recently. And for some of you, raise your hands if this is your first Tauzer lecture live in person. Raise your hands. See, so yeah, there's a lot of new people here. Let's welcome them as well. And I'll just say that, you know, when I first came here, right out of the Obama administration back in 2012, things were different. You know, we had lost 25% of our budget. Students were waiting in line to get classes, sitting in hallways, trying to get in. And now you fast forward to 2023, and it's a much different world than it was before. And the favorite word I used when I gave my first address to the college community was the word pivot. And I think we have pivoted. As the world has changed, we have tried to change with it. And I think that, in essence, is the survival of all animals in the kingdom, animal kingdom, and in all organizations that continue to thrive, is the ability to pivot and change as the world changes in order to meet those changes and stay relevant in today's world. It's just really, really challenging. And it's only through, I think, the community, and I do mean community, and I do mean the word we, that we were able to do this pivot. It's a lot of moving parts in a college. You have your students, you have your faculty, you have your faculty academic senate, you have your faculty unions, you have classified professionals, you have classified professional senate, you have classified professional unions, you have your board of trustees, you have your external community as well, you have what's going on in Sacramento, you have what's going on in Washington, D.C. at the federal level, you know? So there's a lot of moving parts, and I think we have done a really outstanding job of trying to figure out, as Wayne Gretzky, the great hockey player, says, you try to move toward not where the puck is, but where the puck's gonna be. So you try to anticipate where the next step is. I think this college has been very good at doing that, whether it was during the fires, the catastrophic fires that happened in 2017, how we pivoted to try to help our students, our faculty, our former employees and raise funds to support them during their needs, and how we were able to raise a lot of money to support our students. And the mental health services that we put up there, I'm very, very proud of as well, to support our students, because it was very, and employees, it was very traumatic during that time. And then during the time of the COVID, the last few years, when this pandemic fell upon us, I think we were able to really move in a very a logical manner, very strategic manner, in making sure that we followed science and safety first. And I really want to thank our collective bargaining units, AFA, SEIU, because they are the groups that had to work with administration, and we figured it out. It wasn't easy, because it was at a time when you also had this kind of social media and this kind of false narrative of what was happening. And even to this day, there's no unanimity of opinion in terms of what is this COVID. But I'm proud of the way we handled it. I want to appreciate our collective bargaining units. I want to thank Sean, and I want to thank Sandy for their leadership. Let's give them a round of applause. And now we're pivoting toward, prior to the COVID, we were 85% live and 15% remote. Today, we're two-thirds live and a third remote. And whether that's going to change or not, we don't know. But I think it's steadying out. And I think we also have been able to negotiate a working place and the changing of the workplace, where it was unheard of to work from home. And now it's unheard of to have to come to work every day, right? All within a very short span of time. So it's very difficult to make those pivots, you know, in a quick way. And if you have Coach McMillan, who teaches basketball and how to pivot, he spends a lot of time doing that, you know, so that our students are able to make the necessary adjustments that they have to do in order to be successful. So I would say that this college, if you look at the finances, you know, at a time when I came in, we had a $6 million deficit. The L word was being used, and I'm glad we didn't. And I have to say that a lot of the short-term and long-term road to financial recovery rests within one person. That's Kate Jolly. And I want to please give Kate a big round of applause. Because we've gone from a 5% reserve to a 17% reserve during her time here, you know, and that's really amazing. And we're continuing to make progress in that area, and it's really through Kate's really analytical mind and her ability to say, no, Dr. Chong, we can't afford that, that's made that happen. And so I think in the fiscal area and operations, which Kate oversees, I want to really thank all the operations and building and grounds and the custodial staff and all of the people who fix our locks, and we run to our lights are out. You know, we have to do all these. We're still an aging campus even with the bond. So I want to thank all the operational people, custodians, locksmiths, all of you, gardeners, and landscapers. What other community college has a campus as beautiful as SRJC, whether you're at Petaluma, Schoen Farm, Public Safety Training Center, and the Santa Rosa campus? It's all in part due to the quiet work that they do, but keep us operating every day. And I'm proud to say, with the purchase of the Southwest Center, soon to be SRJC Roseland, we're going to put the same investments in there and make that from a third world kind of last picture show kind of campus to something we can be proud of. So I'm really proud of that as well. So. And in the area of student services, you know, I've had the pleasure of working with three of the best, I think, Ricardo Navarrete, Pedro Avila, who now is the president of Gavilan College. I just had beers with him at Juncture this weekend. And Pedro says hello, and he's taken everything he's learned from us and brought it over there. So he said, hey, Dr. Chong, we're going to pass a bond, and we're going to build some student housing. I'm really excited about that. And I said, Pedro, don't forget who taught you all that stuff here at the JC. You know, so I think student services, now under the the leadership of Robert Ethington, where we've made some strides. I want to talk a little bit about mental health. You know, people don't know that I was trained at Berkeley as a social worker. I majored in social welfare, and my first job out of college was at Asian Community Mental Health Services in Oakland, Chinatown. So I know a little bit about mental health services, and we could see that we needed mental health services here, particularly after the fire, and then especially during the COVID, and what's happened during the George Floyd era, that we needed to really step up and develop services for our students. And we also have found out recently, we need to have better mental health services for our employees as well. But speaking of students, I really want to appreciate Robert and his team, Bert Epstein, our Director of Mental Health Services, and Rachel Norwick, our Director of Student Health, for really leading the way to passage of Measure O, where we get a quarter cent tail tax, a portion of it, for the next 10 years to support mental health services just for SRJC students, and that amounts to $805,000 a year for the next 10 years. So we're going to be doing some hiring of bilingual, bicultural counselors, an African-American, a psychologist, social workers, because we are no longer just an educational institution. We're like a community center, because where else are students going to access those type of services were it not for the mental health services that we have? So I'm really appreciative of that. And of course, one of the things I'm really, really proud of course, is the residential student housing. I really want to again thank Robert Ethington, Kate Jolly, and Pedro for leading the way, as well as the housing task force, of which many of you are on, faculty, staff, and students. And I'm really excited to help move in the first roller bags and beanbag chairs in August of 2023. So that's when our student residence hall will open. So let's give a big round of applause for that. So I would just say that wherever we see problems, we try to address them, whether it's food insecurity, housing insecurity, mental health services, and in the area of academic affairs, I still contend that we have the best faculty in the nation, if not in the state, because students will seek us out from all over the country to come here to study, whether it's the dental program, whether it's the nursing program, whether it's pre-law, business, psychology, the humanities, very, very strong departments. And I'm happy to say that in the last few years, I've been interviewing more diverse pool than ever before. And yesterday, I offered a position, I hope I'm not breaking confidentiality, to an African-American sociologist, and she's currently teaching in the United Arab Emirates. You know, so we have people who are now looking at our college and saying, Dr. Chong, when I look at what your core values are, when I look at the professional development opportunities that you're offering today, when I look at what you guys want to do, this is a place I want to be. So I think we have to be modeling for the future so that we continue to be relevant for the future of our students. And I would just say that I couldn't have done it without all of you, and it's really a we. And I feel really proud and really blessed that I had an opportunity to serve as the fifth president of SRJC. And I, again, my heart is filled with gratitude, and I finally get to graduate. So I want to thank you again for everything you've done to make my job so fulfilling, so challenging at times. But nonetheless, I wouldn't change a thing. So I hope to be here and graduate from being a president to a student. I'm going to sign up for a swimming class, because I always wanted to learn how to lap swim and get rid of this gut, because you guys have seen my pictures on Facebook. I need to learn how to swim, and I also want to take some other classes as well. So you haven't seen the last of me. My family, my lovely wife, Lynn, who's been so supportive, and I are going to stay in Petaluma, and we're committed to staying in Sonoma County. So with that, I want to share with you a video that was produced by our public relations as a way to just kind of get things going and show how we're trying to keep up with the times. And so can you guys roll it?
Everyone who goes to college has one thing in common, a desire to grow. Whether you're a high school graduate planning to transfer to a four-year university, or you're looking for the skills to help you switch careers, you may be a parent who's finally able to finish a degree. Whatever path you're on, education is a way to expand what's possible in your life. You want a college that will prepare you for what's ahead. You also want a college that will meet you where you are now. Santa Rosa Junior College has a century-long tradition of academic excellence. It has also grown and evolved along the way. Today, with multiple campuses and sites and a wide range of classes, SRJC offers you the educational choices and flexibility you need to succeed. With vibrant student life and a diverse cultural environment, attracting students from around the world, the beautiful Santa Rosa campus, with its classic collegiate architecture, offers the traditional college experience.
For me, financially, I'm not really able to, like, you know, move out right away to a 4 years. So that's why, you know, the JC picked perfectly for me.
SRJC Petaluma offers a vast array of innovative programs and degrees. The Public Safety Training Center is dedicated to training first responders. Shone Farm is a 365-acre outdoor lab for agriculture and natural resources. And the Southwest Center serves the vibrant Roseland community and offers English as a second language, computer technology, and more. That's how SRJC supports students in areas of interest as diverse as the people who live here.
Attainable in location and like where I am, attainable financially opposed to like going directly to a UC.
Santa Rosa Junior College has so many ways to help you get the education you want with the flexibility to fit with your lifestyle. The college offers scholarships and extensive financial aid for thousands of students who qualify. Counselors guide students' academic experience every step of the way, from registration through graduation or transfer. SRJC offers a more personal, welcoming approach to college. Everything you need to make that education work for you now and to help you discover and achieve your full potential.
I think the JC just does a really good job in making sure that students know that the school is basically here to help them succeed in life.
So if you're looking for a place to grow, if you're looking for a place where students come first, do more than learn. Learn your way at Santa Rosa Junior College.
I want to thank Aaron Bricker, Simona, Dana Throckmorton, Amy Chakuti, and the Idea Cooperative for producing this great piece. And now it's my pleasure to introduce last year's Tauzer lecturer, Dr. Nikki Slovak, to introduce this year's Tauzer lecturer. Thank you very much. Have a great day.
Okay, good morning. I'm so excited to be here. It's so wonderful to see so many colleagues in person again. It's even more wonderful to be standing here in a state of anticipation as we ready ourselves for Dr. George Sellu's Tauzer presentation. As many of you know, it's a tradition for the former Tauzer lecturer to introduce the present Tauzer lecturer by sharing tidbits of their lives, what led them to pursue their academic field of study, and what ultimately brought them here to the JC. Part of the introduction almost always includes the obligatory adorable toddler photo, like you see here, and the awkward teenage shot, although to be fair, this is a pretty fabulous photo of George. I remember from my own Tauzer experience last year providing Sean Brumbaugh, the 2020 Tauzer lecturer, with a stack of old photos from my childhood and wishing him good luck as he went to make his way through it. But George didn't do that with me. He couldn't do that with me because most of the photos of George's childhood and teenage years, like so many people and things, were casualties of the 11-year civil war in Sierra Leone, George's natal country and home. At the time the war broke out, George was working as a high school teacher in Freetown. Fearing what was to come, George fled the city with nothing more than a backpack. Leaving behind two siblings, he made his way largely by foot to the embassy in Guinea, where he stayed until his brother managed to fly him out to Gambia. George found work once again as a high school teacher at a Catholic school in the middle of the country, where he stayed until 1997. When George first shared this story with me over a coffee at Aroma Roasters downtown, I remember feeling humbled, shocked, a little bit awestruck, and somewhat ashamed that I didn't know more about the history of West Africa and the Civil War in the 1990s. I was also a bit embarrassed that I didn't know George prior to last year. I was aware of him. I was aware of his work with DEIA advocacy. I was aware of the JC's Hemp program, which he heads, but I didn't know him. My first impression of George as he walked into the cafe, he actually kind of glides when he walks, so as he glided into the cafe, and was met with various iterations of George, hey George, hi George, by the baristas behind the counter, was that this was a man of authority, charm, intelligence, and immense likability. 90 minutes later, those descriptors still rang true, but I had added grace, wisdom, strength, resiliency, and resolve to the mix. Having now met with George several times since, I think I shall put it this way. George is like his favorite food to cook with, an onion. Layered, complex, reliable, a necessary component to most meals, and whose role, at least in George's case, is willingly chosen, is to enhance the rest of the ingredients in the dish, to bring out the best in others, so to speak, and to remain rather unnoticed in doing so. Perhaps to best understand George's character, we should go back to his beginning, to his birth in Sierra Leone in 1971, the oldest child of George Saar, which you see here on the right, and Melissa Sellu, his beautiful mother, on the far right. His father was an accountant with 5 academic degrees from 3 different continents, and his mother was a successful business owner who managed a restaurant and a nightclub. His father belonged to the Kissi tribe, an ethnic group who lived in the far eastern part of Sierra Leone, so far east, in fact, that it's surrounded more by Liberia than it is Sierra Leone. George was one of 5 siblings, 3 brothers, 2 of whom live in California, and 1 of whom resides in Sierra Leone, and a sister who has since sadly passed away. George's childhood and teenage years were filled with laughter and love, to hear him tell of it. His years at the university in Sierra Leone were meaningful and transformative to him. He seems to have always had a calling as a teacher, first in Sierra Leone, and then later in Gambia, as I mentioned. In 1997, at the age of 28, George made the decision to move to California on a student visa. He enrolled in Contra Costa Community College despite already having a bachelor's degree in agriculture and environmental science. To support himself through community college, George worked at Rite Aid and fortuitously crossed paths with a woman who was to become, in his words, his guardian angel, Heidi Faust Whitmore. A powerhouse in her own right, Principal Faust Whitmore took an interest in George, mentoring him and encouraging him to apply as a substitute science teacher where he could teach kids that, quote, looked like him. George once again made the most of opportunities and became a substitute at Pinole Valley School, working at Rite Aid at night, and then eventually at Richmond High for 3 years. It was his experience at Richmond High that made him realize the impact that he could have on students' lives, a realization that led him to earn his master's degree in agricultural sciences at UC Davis with a minor in education, and eventually his PhD in agriculture and education, also from UC Davis. Around this time, he accepted a job at Florin High School in South Sacramento, a neighborhood characterized by poverty and gang violence. When asked why he was drawn to teach there, he said, in quintessentially George fashion, "Why teach in a place where you can't be impactful? It'd be like using a flashlight in daylight." If it's not yet abundantly clear, for George, education in and of itself is not the end goal. Rather, using one's education to improve the lives of others is what it's all about. According to George, more than half of the fights that he's picked here in his 10 years at the JC have been to defend others who have been trampled on. His daily mantra vacillates between what am I doing with my tenure to make a positive impact and what do I do with my privilege? Here at the JC, he has answered that question in notable ways by helping to establish BLAC, the Black Leadership Association Collective, his work on the Senate, among many other things, but he also helps in under-the-radar ways, like how he mentors those same baristas who chorused his name at Aroma Coffee Shop, driving them to campus over the years when they needed a ride, or advocating for them to various professors to carve out just that one extra seat in an already closed class. You see, for George, you don't have to have a lot of money to help people. As he said, that's joy. I asked George how he came to be that way. Without missing a beat, George answered, my dad. George's dad was the first in his province to have a bachelor's degree and the first in the country of Sierra Leone to have an MBA. His dad put many people through college, according to George, and constantly gave back to his community, often seeking nothing in return. One of George's biggest regrets is that his dad isn't here today to see this. There are, however, many of us here to see George today and to celebrate his accomplishments, including his brother Tamba, but perhaps no one more important than his wife, Fatmata, also from Sierra Leone, and presently the senior economic advisor for the United Nations Development Program. I know! George and Fatmata met in college when he was her math tutor. Although, to be clear, George made it known to me in no uncertain terms that Fatmata is decidedly smarter than him. Okay, so. They married last year and in Sierra Leone, and George is now stepdad to Fatmata's children, Bilal on the left, 16 years old, and Bijou on his right, 13 years old. George's trip to Sierra Leone for his wedding marks only the second time he has been back there since 1997. He returned in 2021, 24 years after the war, and was finally able to see his beloved home country and his childhood home. And his connections to Sierra Leone continue. Once again, in typical George fashion, this relationship with his place of birth is motivated by altruism more than anything else. He asked himself, how can I support farmers in Sierra Leone? The answer? George bought 50 acres of farmland in Sierra Leone a couple of years ago and subsequently established a commercial vegetable farm, hiring 15 women and 4 local men to work it. George meets with them virtually at all hours of the day and night to discuss best practices. According to George, it's the workers and the local community that are benefiting from the farm the most, exactly how George intended it. At the end of our last conversation, I asked George what he did for pleasure. I mean, after all of us, even those as tireless as George seems to be, need a break. His answer, travel, followed closely by dancing, gardening, and cooking. When asked what he would do if he was not a professor, he answered, perhaps not surprisingly, that he'd be a farmer. And then, once again, in typical George fashion, he went on to say, and I quote, if I could retire today, I'd just give people the food they need to survive. What could be better than a life based on feeding people? So with that beautiful thought, please join me in welcoming your fabulous 2023 Tauzer lecturer.
How do I follow that? Wow. Okay. Well, thank you very much, Dr. Nikki Slovak, for that wonderful introduction. And I am humbled, probably at a loss of words at this point, to start thanking the Tauzer committee for selecting me to be this year's speaker. I'm proud and I'm privileged to be here. My younger brother Tamba is here, and my wife is here to see me. And I want to thank all the Tauzer lecturers who came ahead of me, including starting with Dr. Ruben in the audience and the leadership of the college. Thank you for hiring me here, and thank you for giving me the privilege to be an educator at this very fine institution. So when I was asked to give this Tauzer lecture, I was really struggling. How can I condense all the stuff that I want to say in 50 minutes? I said, Nikki, I can't do this. I need about 2 or 3 hours to put this together, right? And so finally I settled on something. I'll call Nikki and we'll chat and we'll talk about it. And so I have something that I hope will actually share with you how I've come to this particular place and this topic that I want to share with all of you today. And so let me grab this remote and get started. Let's get the show on the road. So I chose this topic, centering or rejecting Indigenous ways of knowing. And I didn't come to this point lightly. So this embodies my life experiences, my family, myself, as a person, as an educator, right? And what I'm doing now. And so all of that has been condensed into what I'm gonna talk about today and what that means for me going forward. And so as a true former SLO coordinator at this college, I gotta give you the SLOs that I'm gonna talk about today. And I'm gonna talk about those, and when I'm done, I'm going to come back and review those, all right? I like that clap for SLOs. I like that clap for SLOs, okay? I like to give my students a roadmap. Here's where we're gonna go. And I talk about it, and I say, here's what we just talked about. And if you have any questions, let me know. So these are the expected outcomes for today, okay? So what is Indigenous knowledge, right? I've been thinking about it to myself because I've been farming and talking to farmers and consulting with different farmers across California, across the US, and overseas, and trying to understand. I talk about things and people go, oh, we've been doing that already. My grandpa was doing that. You know, my great-great-grandparents were doing that already. So this is knowledge that has been passed down, right, from one generation to the other. It may not have been recorded. So the Western educators do not know about it because it's not recorded, but it's there. And I'm talking to farmers and asking them, how do you do this? Oh, we know how to do this. But they don't have the vocabulary that we have. That doesn't mean that it doesn't exist, right? So in a lot of cases, I've seen that we've rejected these ways of knowing that are not recorded in the Western setting, right? And those have had tremendous negative impact, health, economic, social impact on people who are not intellectuals or in the academic settings. Are you with me?
Yeah.
And so today I'm going to kind of talk through some of those with you, okay? So, but before we start this conversation, I'd like to ground our conversation. So I'm going to read this to you. Bear with me, okay? It galls us that the Western researchers and intellectuals can assume to know all that is possible to know of us. It appalls us that the West can desire, extract, claim ownership of our ways of knowing, our imagery, the things we create and produce, and then simultaneously reject, I say reject, the people that created and developed those ideas. Let that sink in for a second. Think about all the folks of color. Think about our music. Think about all the things that I'm not talking about today that were created by people of color that have been rejected or have been taken from them and renamed to some new thing, right? Think about it. And this is by a scholar, Native American scholar, who wrote, you know, Decolonizing Methodologies, right? And so think about this for a second and where we're going to go today, okay? So I've been thinking about this, and I said, well, not to understand this, I need to think about what I've been taught in a Western setting and what is taught in indigenous informal learning settings. And I realized that there are similarities and there are differences. Can they coexist? Absolutely. But we have to be willing to listen, to accept those other ways of knowing besides the way we've been taught in Western educational settings. But what they have in common really is the curiosity, right, and long-term observation. Who has observed nature more than you and I? Are the folks who are not in school? They got the time. They got the time. So you might see a kid who is 10 years old, but they have knowledge that is 60 years of knowledge that have been passed down to them from their great-great-grandparents. Are you with me?
Yeah.
But in the Western setting, we don't like that. We don't like inherited wisdom. We reject it. But can we at least start from things that we agree upon, generally observing what's happening around us, right? And finding ways how we can actually explain those things. Or trying to enhance or uplift indigenous ways or different ways of knowing and helping scale those or enhancing those. Instead of saying, no, you're wrong, I don't agree because it wasn't written in my textbook. Hey, don't be quiet now. We've all gone through this, right? We know what I'm talking about, okay? We know what I'm talking about. So again, so some of the things that I was listing down, I started writing, I said, let me write some things that I've come across that are interesting, that I think have been around long before they got these names. In agriculture, one of them is composting. Composting is fairly new, right? We gave it this name, composting, and we think it's fascinating. It's just new stuff, right? So I'm talking to farmers, and they're like, oh, my great-grandpa used to just put the garbage back there, let it decompose, and we'll pull all the cans and bottles out of it. Oh, this was around all the time? Oh, yes. composting is not new. I got news for you. If you haven't turned the radio on, turn the TV on. Composting is not new. And at Shone Farm and around Sonoma County, we got this new thing now called carbon sequestration. We're trying to sequester carbon. Oh, that's new, right? Isn't it new? It's very, very new, right? But guess what? The folks who never went to school have been sequestering carbon because they're keeping the ground cover there all the time to sequester carbon, which will indeed, what, lower global warming, right? These folks have been doing it without a college degree to understand global warming at all. But they never called it carbon sequestration, right? They just knew they had to actually have plans to cover the surface of the ground. So that started, talk about minimum tillage now. Oh yeah, minimum till soil, you know, gotta do minimum till for this new stuff we're doing in ag. This is a new stuff. Who does minimum tillage? These folks didn't have tractors, right? They don't use big tractors. So what are they doing? Minimum tillage. They invented it. Well, we give them no credit for it, right? No credit for it. They invented it. But we gave it a new name, and now it's new. It's new and brand new stuff, right? Grazing pattern, new grazing patterns in Sonoma County, in Yolo County, all those places. And I'm driving around taking pictures going, oh, this was around. What are they talking about? To all my African brothers in the room, I'm going to talk about a few things that you may have seen when you were growing up in Africa. If you're from Eritrea, Ethiopia, West Africa, wherever you are, and my native brothers and sisters, you will see what I'm going to share with you in the next few slides here. Things that you've been seeing over and over that have a new name, and we assume it's new in the Western world. But they've been around. Are you ready for this?
Yes.
Let's do it. Let's do it. Okay? So this stuff right here you see on the very far right-hand side of my, left-hand side of my screen, now in Sonoma County, they say, oh, we're using sheep to graze the vineyards. It's brand new. It is brand new. Oh, this is the new innovation. Right? The farmers who had to grow different crops that they eat and have their own livestock will have, they don't have a lawnmower. So who was the lawnmower? The livestock. Are you with me?
Yes.
But now it's the new grazing pattern. We're giving money to people to do that now because it's brand new. Right? Over here, I was driving in Yolo County. This is an almond orchard. And I stopped, this was last week or so, I took this picture. Because they have this goat over there grazing. This is the new, you know, minimum no-till. We got this goat eating all the grass there. Fire suppression techniques now, they're new. Who was doing that? Indigenous folks have been doing this forever. Give them some love. Uplift their knowledge. Somebody tell me, uplift their knowledge. Okay? Don't be rejecting what they have been doing forever and you're now trying to recast it as something new. Did you hear that? This is not new. They've been doing it. So I've been coming to the realization, because over my first 15 years of teaching, I've been in the same place like all of you. I've been rejecting this because I've been thinking these are new things. So I am now just coming up to this realization, reflecting on my practice as an educator. But these things have been around. How can I enhance them instead of rejecting them and then after a few years recasting them as something new? Okay? So what you see over here on the right-hand side, people cleaning their compost. They don't call it compost. It's their garbage pile that they soak all the time. It decomposes, and they're sifting through it to apply it to their vegetable beds. So I'm like, how can I harness that and work with them to understand what they're doing? On this side, they're collecting ash, fireplace ash, wood ash, to go apply to their plants. And I'll talk about this in the next few slides, how important that is. So with all of these things, I'm going to myself, we have to find a way to work with these folks, right? We have to find a way to understand what they're doing and try to see where we agree, how we can support each other moving forward, because they have thousands of years of observation. We may not agree on everything, right? Not everything's gonna be right from the West or from traditional educators, right? But we need to find an area where we can agree. And so with all of this, I wanted to put together a kind of a summary of where I've been and the journey I've taken. So really, what is informing my pedagogy now are these things around me. My parents' experiences in Sierra Leone in the U.S., right? My experiences as an international student in California. I came to the U.S. with a bachelor's degree, top of my class, finished with a 3.74 undergrad, right? Started college as a math major, by the way. Okay? Math major, that's I was a tutor for calculus. I came to the US and they put me in college algebra. I was so angry. I had to take several tests until I was placed into linear algebra. When I got there, they realized I could be a tutor for linear algebra. Oh, you don't need to hear that. So when you talk about placing, trying to give this placement exam because they don't believe that I got this education, I'm like, we have students here who are going through the same thing with us right now. Okay, I went through that. I was put in ESL classes. I studied in English at an American university from the first grade, okay, till university. Wrote an honors thesis in soil chemistry. Okay, I came here to put me in ESL. I had to challenge everything till I got into English 1A. Got an A in English 1A too, by the way. If I was not forceful, I could have dropped out because I would have been bored taking ESL classes or taking college algebra. How many of our students have been turned away because we reject what they know, how they know it, and where they learn that stuff? So I'm coming to you with this, and when I think about in California, at one point in California, I was one of over 1,000 educators of African descent who taught agriculture in the state of California. High school teachers, community college, and universities. One, and that was me. You think they listen to me? No. They will not talk to me at conferences. I'll go to the meetings for the California Ag teachers. I'll be the only black guy. And they will not listen to me. One time, UC Davis had to send somebody to go defend me because the way I didn't grow up on a ranch in California. But I fought back. Yeah. I fought back. Yeah. And one day, I became the president of that association. Okay? But how many of our students can fight that long? You see, I like to picking up fights, if you haven't noticed yet. For me, it brings joy to be able to pick that fight and win the fights too. I'm very good at strategizing for those fights, okay? So, and I'll talk about a little bit about how I'm farming now, what I'm learning from this farming. This farming I didn't get into easily. I have a friend, a family friend who lives in Sacramento, been begging me to farm for over a decade. Finally, I caved in 2019. I said, okay, let's do it. I'm over it, let's just do it. And it has been one of the most fulfilling experiences for me, just learning some more and expanding, and things that I had a different perspective about that are actually skewed towards the West too much and not recognizing and acknowledging indigenous ways of knowing. And I'm coming to that realization now myself. And have I arrived? Oh, no. I am a work in progress. Okay? Am I going to make it before I retire? Maybe not. But I hope to keep learning new ways, right, of understanding these folks. So I'll talk about my family a little bit. Dr. Nikki talked about this quite a bit. You know, where we're from, if you knew your history, your geography, New York is over here. Okay? Yeah. Okay? So let me talk a little bit about my dad. My dad comes from this part. I got to go back here a little bit. I got to walk this remote pretty well. The Kisi tribe in Freetown. My dad was born in 1930. So the only school I was in his neighborhood only went to the fourth grade. So he had to come to Freetown to go to school. His brother brought him there. When he got there, because the people who were freed slaves lived in Freetown, right? And they all had Anglo names. My dad, Sellu name doesn't fit in Freetown. Yeah, you're from upcountry, you don't belong here. So my dad went to a missionary school, finished high school, and couldn't go to Frobe College. Frobe College is the oldest university in sub-Saharan Africa, and it's built in Freetown, right? My dad was not allowed to go to college there. Why? Because of his last name. They rejected his cultural values. They rejected who he was as a person. They said, no, you can't be here. So he gave up, quit. He was ready to go, but they wouldn't let him. So he went back to his village, taught primary school, moved into Liberia, got a job there, got a scholarship, got to US, Fullerton Community College. He had kids when he was an undergrad. He was in his 30s when he got his bachelor's degree, 37, 38. Okay? He went to school with one of our instructors, Bill Traverso, was his college mate at USF, where he got his bachelor's degree. So he got his bachelor's like at almost 39. Okay? And this guy studied, got a CPA. I'm telling you this story because I'm gonna have the pin right here, okay? He went back home after they rejected him. He went back to his country, armed with an MBA and a CPA. Oh, I'm ready for this. I'm gonna work in my country. They said, "You got an MBA? What the heck is that?" In this country, we have MS and MAs from the UK. We don't know what an MBA is. So you can't get a job walking around here, man. Go back to the US. Who were the folks who were rejecting him when he was in high school and when he got his degrees? Were they white folks? Heck no. Who were they? They were Sierra Leoneans, right? So that's why George picks a fight with people at this college or around his surrounding. When you say, "Oh, we got a black person there, so they must understand how the black people feel." Or, "We got a person of color, yeah, they have to understand how the people feel, because my family has seen this. We've seen this video before. We've seen this game." So my dad got rejected, not by British, but by Sierra Leoneans. What I missed to mention when I was talking about my dad, I'll bring that up in a minute here, is how his name changed over time. And I'll talk about that in a little bit. So this is the school that was downstairs for my dad, but he couldn't go to school there because of his last name. And guess what happened at that high school? I taught there. I taught mathematics there. My dad was rejected at this school. And guess who is the vice chancellor of this university now in Sierra Leone? My first cousin, whom my dad raised. Right. Professor Fodisa. Right? So that's my old man. We have a naming system in our family for the boys. It's Sar. I am Sar. I'm the first boy. My dad was the first boy. My brother Tamba is the second boy. And my younger brother Fire, who lives in Sacramento. And for the girls, we have a naming system. My dad wasn't called George, he was called Sar. So I'd rather you call me Sar in this room, okay? Because that's really paying homage to my parents, my family, and my tribe, Sar. Okay? When my dad got to Freetown, the folks were like, "Well, we can't be calling you Sar around our house. Sar is a kind of a different name, you know? We need you to be called, we need to baptize, we're going to call you George." So he got the name George, rejecting his cultural values. Are you with me? And then that happened, and he came to the U.S., and he was spelling his name, S-A-H-R. They were like, "Sahar," calling him different names that he couldn't recognize. So finally he gave up and he said, just drop the H and just pronounce the S-A-R. So my dad published a book in 1967, An African Perspective of the United States. If you look that up in the Library of Congress, you see the name spelled with S-A, without the H, S-A-R. Brilliant guy. Went to his country, they rejected him, and they said, "You couldn't walk here." So at the age of 46, he goes back to the UK and gets a master's in accounting, and gets the comparable certification as for the CPA, which is the ACCA in the UK, right? All right? Yeah. This man was rejected. Oh, let me talk about my mom before I forget here. Mom is right here. Beautiful. My first teacher, right? My mom. Beautiful. Just saw her a few days ago, and this was a few months ago, this image right here. And, you know, beautiful, very loving person. Studied coronary arts in San Francisco, went home, as Dr. Nikki said, was successful. And she came back to the U.S. later on, years later, to do this hospitality stuff that she really enjoyed, she had a passion for. She couldn't get in the industry. They shut her out. And she couldn't fight. She just gave up and said, "I quit. I'm going to go be a CNA. Think about how many people have been influenced by her smile, by her passion for hospitality in California. Now, I don't even eat African food in California because it's garbage. Think about how many restaurants we'll have had for our influence, but we didn't. And she worked in the healthcare profession, but I never felt she was really happy because that was not her passion. She has a beautiful smile. She likes to host people and treat people right, but she was shut out. Think about that. So that's where I'm coming from when I'm approaching these topics. What would my mom have been? What would my dad have been if not for all the fights that he had to fight? Okay. So I've talked about these things. I'll kind of go through some of these fast and what I'm doing now in terms of the farming, what I'm learning. This is our vegetable production area. So we have about 27 acres under cultivation right now. So every morning I'm on the phone and do a couple, 30 minutes checking with the guys. And we have mostly these are women working for us who, again, if you haven't noticed, a lot of the knowledge is passed down through the moms. Okay, now I know you heard me. Thank you. So what we're doing here is we're farming along farmers and sharing knowledge with them. uplifting what they have been doing and what they know and kind of enhancing what they're doing to make, you know, people need to be acknowledged, right? They might be wrong sometimes, but when they're right, give them their flowers, right? Uplift their knowledge, uplift what they know, right? That's what I've been learning from this process. So I want to go ahead and talk a little bit more about what I've been doing in terms of myself and what I've been learning. So I've talked about improving, how I feel about, you know, this new and improved way of farming that I think, well, it's not new and improved, it's been around. And so I have to change my perspective. And I have to square whatever I learned in the Western school setting to what these indigenous farmers are telling me. I have to square those two. And where there's credit, I'm going to say to my colleagues, this textbook published is as new, but trust me, it's been around for generations. So I have to come to that realization. So that means I'll be doing this for the rest of my life. And it's okay to do that, right? It's okay to do that. And so the last thing on this list I want to talk about is how do you get people, what I've been working on is how do I make myself open to folks to share, make it safe for them to share what they know, how they know it, where they know it, and we can square that. You have to be if we want to change. We have to be. How do we remove those barriers? And how do I view my students as co-creators of knowledge? I'm leaving. Okay? You got to view your community members who are not in the formal setting and your students as contributing to knowledge. And then when you challenge them, guess what they will do? They will rise to the occasion. All day long. All day long. Okay? So what I've been trying to do is to get my... And I'll tell you why I've been doing this and what I've been doing, you know, as a... And of course, I had to throw this in. Because as I'm going through my education and my own self-realization, I said, whoa, your lack of understanding of my ways of knowing should not invalidate what I know. Yeah. So it doesn't mean that because how those farmers farm wasn't recorded in the books, that it's not valid. So that's why I'm always cautioned nowadays to say, hey, as documented. Because I don't know, something that happened that may not have been documented, right? So I have to acknowledge that. So that way, if it comes up later on, that I don't look like a fool. Okay? So now I'm going to take you through a small thing I learned, like a little kind of a lesson or a lecture that I'll give in a class, right? And I'm going to talk about how this fits in with indigenous ways of knowing. So here we go. So farmers need to understand plant nutrition, because plant nutrition determines your harvest, your yield, and all those things. But we have some fancy names. We have some macronutrients. We have some micronutrients the plant need in small amounts. And we have classified them even further into primary micronutrients and secondary macronutrients. But the indigenous farmers don't know that. All they know exactly my plant needs this type of nutrients. How do I make them available? Okay? So, in order for us to work with these folks, I've been thinking about how can we support some of this work, right? But then I've been thinking about also where I farm in Sierra Leone, which is a tropical area. In tropical countries, they have a lot of rain, like 5 to 6 months of rain. And that causes some problems for soils. In high elevation areas, even in the US, you have high leaching of salts. So you end up with what? Acid soils. And acid soils are not good for plant growth. Bear with me, the chemistry, folks. It's going to be short, okay? Just bear with me. I'm going to be short on the chemistry, okay? So here's what an acid soil will look like, right? So acid soils are not good because for you to get the right nutrients in the soil, you have to have the right condition, whether it's moisture, whether it's pH, all of those things have to be right for you to get the nutrient availability, okay? But imagine, I'm talking about farmers who never went to school. How do they understand how to manage this, the soil nutrition, right? So we have this thing called this pH scale that we've developed, right? That says that we have to have an optimum pH for nutrients to be available. So even if you apply all this NPK, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium to the soil, if you don't have the right pH, they will not be available for the plants to use. Are you with me?
Yeah.
So if you are in an area where you have a tropical area, the pH would normally be down here. And these macronutrients that you see up here, These macronutrients here, NPK, which are our primary macronutrients, are available in this pH range right here. So even if you apply tons and tons of those, if your pH is down here, they will not be available to the plants, and you have poor yield. But these farmers never went to school, and they figured this out through lots and lots and lots of observations. So what did they do? They've been doing some things to fix this. And the way you fix this is to add some lime. When you add some lime, the lime will bring the pH up this direction so that the nutrients can be available. You don't need a chemistry class yet, just now, okay? They have figured that out. And if the pH is also very low, if it's very acidic, you will affect the beneficial soil microorganisms as well. They will not thrive. So what have these folks been doing? They've been trying to manage this on their own. And what have they done? They have used different ways. In the West, we've told them, use industrial lime, right? And they have been using what we call wood ash to fix this problem, because ash is lime. You add it to the soil, it brings the pH up a little bit, and while other nutrients will be available to the plants, the plants will grow well and give you the yield that you want. How did they get to know this? We don't know. They've been doing observations, and they've tested this out over decades. We give them industrial lime, which may have a lot of problems with it, because with places like Sierra Leone or have a lot of rain, this ends up in the stream, and most of these folks don't have pipe-borne water. They collect water from the stream. This ends up in the drinking water, and I don't know what the health implications would be. Somebody help me understand that. Or they could be using their wood ash to fix this problem. All right? Are we there? So this is one of our farmers farming next to us. So I had the guys take a video of this beautiful woman applying some stuff to her plants here. She's applying some wood ash from the fireplace. And all the Africans in the room will understand this. You've seen this when you were growing up as a kid. What is she doing right now? She never went to school. But she's trying to fix a problem. We know that from what I just told you in the previous slides, right? What is she trying to fix right now? Fix the pH. She doesn't need a PhD in chemistry. She has hundreds of years of experience from her great-great-grandparents on how to fix this. Right? Are you with me? Can I help? Can I help them enhance this? Can I help them scale this up without rejecting what they know? Can I help them actually test the potency of their wood ash so we know exactly how much to apply and when to apply it? I could do that without rejecting what they know. Oh boy. We can do that without rejecting what they know, right? I hear you. So I'm talking about West Africa. I want to bring this back home. In the US now, we're doing, our native brothers and sisters are doing what we call what? Cultural burnings, right? The person there is Professor Bette Rose Middleton at UC Davis. They're doing cultural, and some of our colleagues in this room are also participating in this. And they're doing this. And you talk to them for the reasons why they're doing this, they could have been in Africa doing this. It's been passed on to them. And now guess what? Even though we've said this is not the best way to do this, now even Cal Fire is doing what? Adopting this. They rejected it, right? They said it was primitive. We can't use this. It's too primitive. Now Cal Fire is trying to adopt this. The UC system is adopting this thing. Why are we rejecting thousands of years of experience and knowledge? Can we enhance it without rejecting what they know? Remember how we grounded this conversation? We don't have to reject this. We can acknowledge that it exists. And we can fix areas that we think it's a little lacking. We can extend it, right? We can enhance it without rejecting it. Are you follow me? Okay, so I need to do some other stuff here. I want to just, these are the things that I've talked about. And one thing I want to mention right now in Sierra Leone, in West Africa, what's happening is, because we've forced these folks to leave their wood ash, they're using lime. Now that there's a war in Ukraine, what has happened to the supply chain for lime? Gone. Now they're sitting there and they're going, oh, there's all this food insecurity in the world. I can tell you why. If you had enhanced their ash application, they will not be waiting for industrial lime. They will not be waiting for industrial lime, right? And they will have food, because that ash will help them unlock the nutrients in the soil. So I'm asking myself, how can we coexist with indigenous farmers who have not gone to formal school and make sure that what they're doing to fix this problem, that we can scale that up and we can extend it without saying what you're doing is garbage, it will never, because it's not in our textbook. You know how many students are coming in and having these ideas and we're saying it's garbage and they just shut down and walk away? There are a lot of them. So think about it now as you talk about it. Be open and have this conversation with your students. And so as a DEI educator, right, what do I need to do? I need to be open to diverse ways of knowing, diverse ways of understanding, right? And make sure I provide access. Access. So the students actually feel like they have a place in the classroom, or they have a place on this campus, or they have a place in our community, because we're uplifting what they know and how they know it. Doesn't mean we're going to agree all the time. Does that make sense? There are going to be times when we're going to have things that do not agree with what we know, and we can say, this doesn't square. We can't explain this. We don't think it's right. And that's okay. But you can find areas where you agree, where you have common understanding, right? And we can find those places and make our students feel... you know, I had a student who was supposed to give me video for this talk, who is a Native American leader, and I was asking them to do a report on food crops. Talk about the cultivation, just one, because I was teaching a lesson on ethnobotany. And I said to him, well, you can do it on all these crops. And the student said, well, hey, George, can I do it on this? I go, sure. So this student actually, she had the best presentation because she had been she's been involved with all of this research with her grandparents, great-grandparents, and everything. And she came and did a wonderful presentation on crops that are not regularly grown because they're only grown, you know, like on reservations. And all the students in the class just ate it up. They were so excited. And when that student gave a workshop at the Petaluma campus for We the Future, our workshop was packed, standing room only. Because what did I do? I didn't do anything. I just uplifted her understanding. I didn't pay her money. She didn't pay me money. I just uplifted what she knew. Okay? So that's what I've been doing. So how do I get to this point? So I'm going to go over a couple images here. When we started growing hemp at Shone Farm, the knowledge about growing hemp was absent. For over 80 years, nobody was growing it. The knowledge was not at the University of California, Davis. I know that for sure. They didn't teach me this over there. It wasn't at the university. But there were people, you know, on the ground who had the knowledge, informal knowledge that they had about this, right? And I had to figure out a way to get that knowledge. And the only way is to get my former students who were, you know, different colors, different ethnicities, who have been growing this and have a lot of experience from their grandparents, their parents about this crop. I had to talk to them about this crop so I can square that what I know from agronomy. Does that make sense? So all of that information that we had, right, that I have now, wasn't there when I started. So talking to my students, talking to community members who are not educators here, what do you know about this crop? Traveling all over the state and all over the country to understand that crop, right? And talking to farmers in Sierra Leone, like Kekula right there, the guy who's one of our farm managers, we're talking about composting, and I said, so how does composting thing go? He goes, well, you know, we just pile this garbage, and it decomposes, and we burn it at the end and apply it to the soil. I'm like, okay, this sounds like compost in my head. Well, why are you burning it? And he said, well, we have to kill all the pathogens and all the weed seeds. And I'm like, oh, that makes sense. Because in regular composting, we cover the compost with tarp to heat it up, to pasteurize it, so we can kill the weed seeds and the pathogens. That's what we're doing with fire. I'm like, wow, mind blowing. So I said, you know what? We do the same thing, but we do it with tarp. I said, why don't you avoid burning it so you don't kill like the useful pathogens? How about we just cover it with plastic? But I did not reject his way of knowing. I said, I agree with it, but here's how we can tweak it. And he was all over it because he's had that tarp for months and he wouldn't use it. Now that I uplifted what he knew, and I just added this other component to it, and we agreed on how we could improve it, and he's all over it, so now he's composting. He doesn't call it composting. I'm still working on him because he calls it dirt, and I say, you can't call it dirt. I said, because it has life, you know, it has life, you can't call it dirt. But you know what, but we're having fun. I'm learning from them, and they're learning from me. So that's what I'm doing as an educator, learning from them, learning from my students, challenging them in areas where I think they need to be challenged, uplifting what they know, and I think that's the position that I'm in. And I am going to be a work in progress till I retire. Okay? Over here on the far side, they were struggling with fertilizer issues in that whole village where we're farming. And I'm like, what do we do? You have all this livestock. Let's collect all the waste, put it in these barrels, We use those biogas to ship stuff to Sierra Leone. And so we're mixing the cow manure and that stuff. And now we're trying to fast track the process. We're adding molasses to it. And that is fertilizer, cheap fertilizer now that we're giving them free. And the crops that you saw earlier, those nice looking okra, that's the fertilizer we're using now. Environmentally friendly. They can source all the materials locally. We don't have to rely on international global supply chain. They already knew this. I just enhanced it with the molasses to make that decomposition faster. Are you with me? Are you following me here? And now, I'm into burning. I'm burning. See, this is how one of our fields we're trying to clear up, right? We're burning that stuff. So my cultural burners in the room, you know what this is about, you know the benefits of doing this, I'm doing it with them. We're having fun. Here we're doing some drip irrigation. They didn't want to do it at all. But I said, hey, you know, I can help you extend what you're doing right now with water. Here's how we can do that. They rejected it for a while, but once we saw that they can extend their season next to the other farmers, they've adopted it. So you see how we can work with this, right? How we can work together, we can coexist without saying, no, it's either you do it the Western way or nothing. They're doing drip irrigation now, and they bought into it. They love it, okay? So, and I've been talking about all those things, and you ask, well, George, you talked about hemp, Dr. Nikki talked about hemp, and you haven't mentioned hemp yet. Well, I'm glad you asked that question. Because you better believe I'm gonna talk about hemp. And then Goldstein is here to listen to this, and I love it. Why do I wanna talk about hemp? I think hemp gives us a perfect vehicle to actually talk about ways in which we've rejected indigenous ways of knowing and the economic, social, and health implications for doing that. I'm gonna take you through it right here quickly, okay? So what I've been thinking about this hemp stuff, as a young man, I have this plant. It's one of the most versatile plants that we know that exists, that you can use every part of this plant. Whether you're doing building materials, whether you are making topicals, whether you're doing lotion, you know, packaging material, paper, textile, rope, you name it. Even parts now for Teslas. Yes. And guess what? This plant was rejected. But in order for you to understand why this plant was rejected, I have to take you through a little bit of history in a little bit here. But let me talk generally about the crop, because people try and kind of misunderstand what this crop is. There are three plants in the Cannabaceae family. One is industrial hemp. The other one is THC cannabis, right, which has high levels of tetrahydrocannabinol, THC, which is a psychoactive component. And we have hops, if you drink beer. They're in the same family as these three. That's the two crops. So, really, THC level in industrial hemp has to be equal to or less than 0.3%. And THC level in THC cannabis or marijuana has to be normally on average about 15%. That's 50 times more. So you're not gonna get high on this thing. Okay? So don't worry about it. So don't go to Shone Farm looking for it because, it's not gonna help you. Okay? It's not gonna help you. Okay? So here we got some examples. I have images here. This is what we call a dual hemp crop. This is actually the one on the far left is grown for seeds, right? And so grain and flour and oil. So we use the flour for oil. And the middle one is what we had at Shone Farm. This is an image actually from Shone Farm, right? And this actually we grow, this is a CBD hemp, we grow just for oil. So we get the flour and we do extraction of that flour to get oil. The last one here, this is fiber hemp that we plant high density to make your building materials, ropes, and so forth. Okay, so they're very different crops in the way they look. The one in the middle though looks very much like your THC cannabis in terms of the physical appearance. Okay, so I don't want people to conflate those two things. Oops, sorry. I guess I got to walk this remote right. Those trucks are just baling, industrial hemp. So for fiber, they're baling those out for make ropes and so forth. So again, this crop has been very useful. Right here, we're seeing this is used to make packaging. This packaging is 100% plant-based, okay? We're using hemp herd that are decorticated, and the binding agent is actually mushroom. Wow. Yeah, so talk about microplastics, right? These are packaging that we're using now with styrofoam and plastic packaging for cosmetics. We could have used hemp for that. And talk about, well, we have all this microplastic in our fish and in the ocean, all that stuff. We could have fixed that with hemp. But we didn't, because we didn't want to hear the conversation. We have created, you know, we have actually had, we've had medicines developed, right? Drugs developed, that in this case, we're using it actually to manage epilepsy from this crop. Why would somebody ban a crop like this? Why? Right? We're using it for phytoremediation, to suck out heavy metals that are toxic for humans from the soil, whether they're arsenic, lead, and so forth from the soil. Why would you ban a crop like this? I've been trying to understand this for a while. And now, the medicinal aspect of this, right? It has been used extensively to manage a bunch of things. And in your system, all of you in this room, every one of you has what we call an endocannabinoid system. Turn to your friend and say, you have an endocannabinoid system. It's news for you, right? But the endocannabinoid system, cannabinoids in your body that help actually keep a bunch of systems in balance. So anxiety, appetite, pain, and those receptors actually send those messages to help you manage pain differently, or perception of pain. So cancer patients, that's why they use this. Okay? Anxiety, up, endocannabinoid system tries to bring that back in balance. So when the body cannot produce enough cannabinoid to do this, that's why we use the phytocannabinoids that come from this plant to help enhance your endocannabinoid system. Why would you ban a crop like this? You will ask, why would you ban a crop like this? Okay? So I wanted to go over some of the things. But before you know that, I'd like to talk about some of the little bit of the history. I think I got some time here to talk about the history of hemp, where hemp has been. So we said hemp came, you know, from China and that part, and in the US we said hemp was cultivated first in 1619. But I underline documented, because that is just what is documented. When we got to what is now called Virginia, modern day Virginia, when folks got there, there was hemp growing all over. And who was living there at that time? Who was living in what is now Virginia at that time? Anybody knows history? This is a quiz question. It's a Family Feud or something. Okay? Native Americans were there. But they did not write about it. They had the knowledge here. So who had the knowledge about this crop? Before we even document anything about this crop, Native Americans had the knowledge. Former presidents, right? George Washington, Jefferson, Benjamin, made a bunch of their money from growing what? Hemp! And then hemp became illegal after they made money. Yeah, it became illegal. They made their money and go, okay, now it's illegal. You can't do it. You can't do it. You can't do it. Okay? So again, and so I give you, I'm going to go by a timeline here for you to see what has happened in hemp. So some of the things I want you to remember is farmers were required by law to grow hemp. They were required to grow hemp. Our first draft of our Declaration of Independence was written on what paper? Hemp paper. Oh my. But hemp is illegal. Hemp is illegal. Over here, the government's own agency, USDA, said hemp produces 4 times more paper per acre than our trees that we're cutting down. Why would you stop growing hemp and start cutting down, logging those trees? The things that people have gone through to reject indigenous knowledge blows my mind. Blows my mind. And what the interesting one I want to share with you is over here, okay? The Mechanics magazine was one of the most popular magazines in the US. So they had a story ready to go to talk about how hemp can be used in 25,000 products. But the problem is they didn't have paper to print the story. So the story was delayed by 1 year. So by the time the story came out, they had already passed this marijuana tax, very high tax, to prohibit people from growing this crop. Not making this up. Government papers, right? Government papers. Why would you stop this? And look at that document. Made from hemp paper. Okay? That document. Things that we believe in, right? And I'll give you more of a timeline. So during the war, when we're losing the war, Now they've put all this tax on hemp. They say, you can't grow it. You're going to pay all this money because hemp is crazy. You can't do it. And what did they do after that? They actually called everybody and said, oh, we're losing the war. And they have this whole campaign called Hemp for Victory. Want everybody to go back and grow hemp. Now they said, oh, the president's made their money. Stop growing it. We're going to tax you. Oh, now we're losing the war because they needed the hemp to make all the ropes for the sailboats and everything else. So the only way they could win that war was to talk about this thing that we talked about during COVID, the Defense Production Act. Where did it start? It's over there. Because they needed hemp in order to win, in order for defense to win this war. We went back, produced hemp, and then they said, oh, okay, now we've won the war. We got everything we want. Let's go back now and put all these laws in place to protect you, for prevent you from growing hemp. Okay? So we see here that they had the strict policies against possessing hemp or marijuana, what of those, any of those, right? But the scary part is they scheduled hemp as being more dangerous than fentanyl. Go look it up. Google it when you live here, or Google it on your phone now, right? Hemp was, according to the federal government, hemp was more dangerous than fentanyl. And we know what fentanyl is causing in our country right now. Let's don't diminish that. And they're saying this was more dangerous. Why were they doing all of this? There was money involved, right? There was money involved. And they went all out. All this propaganda by the timber industry, by the fossil fuel companies, so they can sell plastics, right? All this crazy stuff, you know, talking about Mexicans over there, talking about black folks, talking about Native Americans here, all this crazy propaganda based on nothing. Because think about if Native Americans who had the knowledge and black folks who were enslaved, who had the labor, right, ran these industries, where would the money be today? Think about if all the African Americans in the U.S. had the paper and the packaging industry for Amazon. Hey, we're talking money, right? Lots of money, right? But no, they scare people away with all this propaganda. So again, what am I talking about here? Who had the knowledge? These tobacco companies. Tobacco companies were campaigning against hemp. And now what's happening, as they've legalized hemp, what has happened? All the tobacco farmers in Kentucky are now growing what? Hemp. Only after we've killed so many people from consuming tobacco, now finally we realize, oh, maybe we were wrong 80 years ago to stop growing hemp and growing tobacco. Oh, maybe we were wrong trying to make packaging out of plastics instead of using hemp, right? Oh, maybe we were wrong cutting down all the trees when we could have used hemp to do that. Only now. But they have the money. Can somebody ask them if they can return the money back? I'd like to know. Okay? So who had the knowledge? Who had the knowledge? It wasn't the people who were seeing now in the business. The federal government, you know, they scheduled hemp. We got the document. Everything was good. Benjamin and I and my colleagues were busy working on trying to get this stuff together to teach about hemp here. But I want to ask the question. When they legalize hemp or they schedule hemp, does that mean we can just go forward and just start and everything will be fine for our students? No. Can they have access to land? Do they have access to money? How about those who were in prison for having hemp? It's on their record. Can they actually own a business? No. So we can't just start now and go forward and see whatever happened, because people already have the money from that time. Let's go back and revisit what happened then before we can go forward. It's very quiet up there, folks. Okay? So our students need us to be engaged in. So let's hear what Martin Luther King has to say about this. Okay?
At the very same time that America refused to give the Negro any land, through an act of Congress, our government was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that it was willing to undergird its white peasants from Europe with an economic floor. But not only did they give the land, they built land-grant colleges with government money to teach them how to farm. Not only that, they provided county agents to further their expertise in farming. Not only that, they provided low interest rates in order that they could mechanize their farm. Not only that, today many of these people are receiving millions of dollars in federal subsidies knocked upon, and they are the very people telling the black man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps.
We just can't go forward. Are you with me?
Yeah.
We gotta look backwards and think about what was taken away, what was destroyed. That's not a lecture on reparation, which I'll give at some other time at this college. Okay? Okay? So our students going into the world that we're training to be farmers, right? And agriculturists and all of these folks going into these industries, we need to prepare them. And we need to know that we know what's happening in the real world. They're getting a degree to go be a farmer. Can they really farm? I don't think so. There are a lot of barriers in their way. How do we remove those barriers as DEIA educators? How do we help them navigate that system better? So you can't do that in the classroom alone. You cannot. Trust me, you can't. You have to be out there in the community, involved with policymaking, all outside the classroom to help students be involved with that. So what have I done? When they started talking about hemp in this, in Sonoma County, and they were putting together an ad hoc committee to talk about policy, I volunteered my time to be the technical expert for the Ag Commissioner's team to help craft the ministerial permit for Sonoma County, which, by the way, has now been used across the whole of California and Oregon and Washington. And also, I decided to do a study at Shone Farm. And let's give a shout out to the Shone Farm team, the farm managers, the team, and everybody, okay? Okay? Because I was on this wild, crazy ride to investigate terpene drift. What are terpenes? Terpenes are the aromas or flavors that come from plants. A lot of plants have different aromas. And depending on the combination of different aromas, you can have different terpene profiles. So you remember the scare we talked about when we were scaring people about this, you know, devil's harvest, all that stuff? It was happening in Sonoma County. Oh, we can't grow hemp around here. It will taint our crops. It will do this. I'm like, do you know you already have those terpenes in your farm, in your backyards already? So, and they were making up the story with no evidence. So I said, well, show me the research. And nobody could show me the research. So your own Shone Farm team in the Ag Department, led by myself, put out the first white paper in the U.S. about the potential of terpene drift in the U.S. Okay? So that put to rest that propaganda, and that is why we were able to grow hemp in Sonoma County and across the state of California. So I've testified in so many county offices, Santa Barbara, San Luis Obispo, Placerville, and in other counties, in Oregon, Lake County, all those places, with that white paper. So that is taking away the barrier for my students. I'm doing that, but I need all of you, right, to remove those barriers for our students, right, to get in the industry. So I wanted to share with you, because this is something that I enjoy looking at. It's just for fun to show this to some people who are complaining about a terpene drift, right? All those plants you see there, they all have terpenes. They all share the same terpenes. These are different terpenes. If you want like a lemony flavor, you go with limonene, which is over here. You have that in wine grapes, you have it in lemons, you have it in other citrus, right? It gives you that lemony flavor, okay? So there are different terpenes. And those terpenes actually, people were saying that they would drift from the hemp plant and taint our crops. We have not found any evidence of that. So that's why they didn't like me. And I said, okay, you don't like me now? Well, you watch me. I'm going to take this show on the road to talk to everybody about it, okay? So again, we've done that, and we've removed barriers for people to actually grow hemp in the county. And one of the things that I want to talk about, Dr. King talked about it, we think things are fine, we've descheduled hemp so we can move forward. No, we can't, because people don't have access to land. Remember, 90% of the land in Sonoma County is privately owned. Privately owned. How can our students become farmers? We don't have access to land. And people have used that from what they collected back then. They've passed it on from generation to generation. So we've got to remove that barrier of land ownership. We have to before we go forward. We just can't say, everything is fine now. Oh, slavery is over, so let's move forward. Oh, you know, now hemp is legal, let's move forward. No, not so fast. Let's look behind, think about what happened, and then we can plan to go forward. Okay? So I've been thinking to myself about what can I do, right? What can I do? How can I actually move this work forward? As I'm running up on my time here, I'll be 2 minutes, whoever, timekeeper, watch me. I'm going to go through this real fast. Some of the things that I really want to talk about, right, What am I doing in order to make sure I remove those barriers for my students, right? Who has the knowledge for hemp cultivation? It's not you and I. It's the folks who are not in these classrooms, not on these campuses. They are indigenous folks who have that knowledge up and down from here to Humboldt, you know, in the areas, you know, where we can't see them. They have the knowledge, right? But who owns the dispensaries in Sonoma County? Ain't those people, right? Who own the dispensaries? We don't see any people who've been incarcerated for growing hemp. We don't see them owning those dispensaries, right? So we need to fix that. And we have privilege, working at SRJ, I have privilege of tenure. I can go to a meeting, I can say what I want to say, right? And they don't do anything to me, they're not going to fire me, right? They're not going to fire me. It'd be too costly for them to fire me, right? Too costly for them to fire me. So here we go. So again, how can we fix this problem? Okay? How can we fix this problem? So I've talked about my top in drift study, right? I've talked about hemp policy that I've helped create to make sure we can open doors for students and our community members to get in, and working on compliance issues. So I've been involved with hemp policies across the country, not just for me, nothing to do with me, but to make sure we provide access for folks who have this knowledge, they've been rejected, and how do we get them back in the game? How do we get them back in the game? So here, I'm gonna go through a few slides here just quickly. Here is me presenting, I'm being interviewed by the Farm Bureau, one of the largest farming organization in the country. I'm giving a talk to the folks who are the wine grape growers in Napa. They had me as a guest speaker in the education series, just to spread the word so we can remove barriers for our students. That's what we're trying to do, remove barriers for our students to get in. And so that with their knowledge, whatever they have is not gonna die with them. Most of these people up in Humboldt, they have hundreds of years of experience passed down to them. Are we gonna let them die with that knowledge? Or are we gonna bring them out of the, you know, out of the woods and help uplift that? Okay? And here, they were doing something on equity assessment for the county on ownership of dispensaries. And again, they asked me to give them ideas. And I was happy to talk about it because at the end of the day, this removes barriers for our students, yeah. Right? So I was interviewed with one of our former students here, Elias Hinnett, who was our graduation speaker, was also interviewed for this piece. This whole piece is about talking about equity and access to people who have been incarcerated, who want to get in the industry. How can we give back what we took away from them? That's not part of my load, is it? So I'm giving all of this, right? I'm giving these talks. I'm going to these big conferences to talk about terpene drift, to make sure we can remove barriers. This was in San Luis Obispo County, talking to all vintners across the US about this lie about terpene drift. And what did that do? It removed barriers for growers. It removed barriers for growers. That's what I'm trying to get at, right? And that white paper, this is on ResearchGate, has been viewed 1,300 times. Right? And it has been cited in several ordinances across the state of California, Oregon, and Washington. I don't get money for that, but I'm helping remove barriers for community members who have the knowledge, who can be successful in these industries. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Okay. So here we go. This one was done by a colleague of ours who writes for the local Vox as an associate faculty in English. Was writing about land ownership, and I wanted to chime in on what we could do to remove barriers for students who want to farm. And that was a great piece, and you can look it up, Google it, and you can find it, right? All of that is just meant to create access so we can have these folks who have indigenous knowledge to be able to practice and share with us so we can land together and coexist together. That's all I'm trying to do. I'm not looking for money. Just try to get folks to uplift their knowledge, challenge them where we could challenge them, and scale up what they're doing. That's all I'm trying to do. So in my class, what I've done is to really bring this up and invite students, right? I'm inviting them to say, I don't know what you know, I don't know how you learn best, but I would like for you to tell me. I would like for you to share with me. That's how I got that student I mentioned earlier on. That's how I got her to actually come out and share phenomenal understanding of the plants that they grow up in the reservation where I haven't been. I learned a lot from her, and I'm still talking to her about things that she does today. And so that's part of my development. So as I wrap this up, I want to challenge all of you. Friends, we could do better. We could do better, okay? Turn to that person next to you again this time. Maybe if you did right, did left, do left this time. Say, we could do better. Okay? And as my friend Dr. Brumbo will say, in order to go forward, we got to look backwards first, right? And then we can go forward with a clear mind that we've addressed those things that happened in the past. Are you with me? So I invite all of you, I invite all of you to go back to this Venn diagram, think about how we can coexist with people who have indigenous knowledge and how they practice, and how we can move learning for our students forward. I want to thank the committee. I want to thank all my friends and family in this room for giving me the privilege to share my passion and what I know now, and I hope you follow me in this learning experience. Thank you all. And now, it is my distinguished pleasure to introduce somebody who I hold in high regard, who has contributed tremendously to this institution, who was the first Tauzer lecturer, Professor Dr. Bob Rubin, to share a very important background to this event and the founder of this event. Thank you very much.
George was great. And I've listened to a lot of these lectures, and I've enjoyed every damn one of them. But this one was tremendous, and I really appreciate it. I've known George for a long time, and we've become good friends. And I have a new appreciation for his person. He's a gem, and the college is great to have him, and we're happy to have him. The short version is I'm supposed to make a couple of announcements. One is that those of you that signed up for box lunches, those will be available in the Bertolini Center just before noon. And the second announcement is that I would like to mention to you that there'll be a follow-up workshop here in the auditorium on Tauzer lecturers and the whole pattern of how they've come to be. And then finally, I was hired here before George was born, and that was a time ago. This was all black, and so on. And I thought the place was magnificent when I first came, and I haven't changed my mind. I never second guessed what everybody thinks about when they get their first job. And when I was interviewed, Dr. Rand Newman interviewed me, and Brooke Tauzer interviewed me, along with members of the department. They asked me first to come for an interview after they'd rejected my application in a handwritten note from Rand Newman, who commented on my abilities and my transcripts, and I'd never received a handwritten note in a job rejection before. And at any rate, I thought, this is the coolest place ever, and if a president writes you a handwritten note and has read all your stuff, this must be a swell place. And it turns out that I was right. I came for a job, but I couldn't come because I worked all day. And I couldn't come at the time they wanted, so they scheduled the interview for 8:30 at night on a Friday. And we all showed up, and it was terrific. And at the end of this, where they didn't ask me very much about what I knew, it was just talk about ideas. Rand Newman stood up and thanked me for coming, and I said, you know, this happened so fast. You guys asked me to come after the fact, and I wasn't planning on it, and so on, and I've never filled out an application. And Rand said to Brooke, Brooke, I don't believe we have applications, do we? And Brooke was a tall man, a wonderful orator. He stood up and said in his booming voice, indeed, we do not. So I'd like to invite you to the Tauzer lecture or the follow-up on the Tauzer lecture, where a number of people that admire Brooke as an icon of this institution will remember his life here and the contributions he made to the college. I appreciate very much having the opportunity to speak to you, and I hope to meet you all at some point personally. Thank you.